Brought to you by Penguin.
The Key in the Lock by Beth Underdown. Read by Laura Kirman. Prologue. I still dream every night of Polneath on fire, smoke unravelling from an upper window, and the terrace bathed in a hectic orange light. And every morning I wake convinced that Tim is under my bed. 30 years have elapsed since the business at Polneath. I have married Richard, given birth to Tim, mothered him and watched him grow. But I see now that the decision I made at Polneath was the only decision of my life. Everything marred in that one dark minute. I've got as far as I can now with writing it down, but the dream will not shift, and the feeling of Tim beneath the bed every morning grows, if anything, more distinct. I suspect it is because the Polneath business is not finished still. Not yet. I cannot say where it will end. But I know perfectly well where it began. With the stopped mills amongst the damp trees, the silent house, and the death of a child. Somebody else's son. The kitchen clock in my father's house, ticking on past midnight. Tea on the table, well stewed, and the coals in the grate subsiding comfortably. And a woman, a girl, really, 19 years of age, with her 3 good frocks and her habit of biting her index finger. Myself, as the flames licked upwards a mile away, looking at the clock and waiting. Chapter 1. 1918. Our son Tim was killed in February, 10 months ago now. This is the first Christmas, and in that sense alone was always bound to be difficult. Today is the 23rd, and only this afternoon did I make the customary garlands for the dining room fireplace. Jake brought in the greenery and deposited it on the floor of the study, with a nervous glance at me. I suppose he is still wary after the trouble I have caused these last weeks. At any rate, he brought in his armful of ivy and mistletoe and willow, as I'd asked him to, without a word, as though he were any other servant. Making the belated decorations, I found a spider's egg sac frozen amongst the foliage, which turned to a kind of dust as I touched it, making me shudder, leaving me sad at its ruined hopes. I finished the garlands quickly and had Mrs. Fawcett pin them up, though of course I eat alone these days. Breakfast, luncheon, dinner, the chair opposite quite empty. Nobody to enjoy the garlands but me. I do not think the Fawcetts care much about garlands, but still I am glad I made them, if only so that something, anything, might be as usual. Now my painful hands are leaving green marks on the page. It is dreadful, of course, not to have Tim here, though in fact this will be the 3rd year I have missed seeing his face on Christmas Day, 1915. That was the last time. Tim's training was finished, and in the January, he would be going over. He was like marzipan on Christmas cake, smooth and thick as a counterpane. But I hadn't been able to get the sugar for it. The afternoon he came home, I was still fussing with the cake, how to make it look less bare, while Jake went to the station to collect him. After his previous visit home, I was resolved this time to keep an irreproachable grip upon my emotions. I tried to tell myself I was reconciled to Tim's going. I had held out against his joining up. Then they had come in the summer to make lists of all the men. Only that, only lists. But it suddenly seemed inevitable. Tim had turned 19, in any case, and volunteered. Then, a week before his visit, the list makers had come again to the house. I'd told them the truth, that Fawcett was over the age, Jake not quite, but that one of his legs was 2 inches shorter than the other, and he cannot run without pain. I answered the men's questions, Fawcett hovering nervously at my back, and told them that they already had our boy. Our only boy. When Tim arrived, he was in uniform, a dreadful, stiff thing. He looked older. He kissed me tenderly and gave me one or two wry looks, while Mrs. Fawcett brought tea and Richard began to deliver what he considered to be the men's news. Smuggling convictions in the district, a mare sold as pregnant who turned out only to have a tumour inside her the size of a grapefruit, disputed fence boundaries. He was thinking of reviewing the rents for the top fields. The drainage needed repair by the bottom road. I sat, picking the bits of peel out of my cake, and tried to admire Richard's assiduousness, his attention to detail, his ability to be ordinary, even in the face of this. But the dull green-brown of Tim's uniform insisted upon itself, and I looked at Richard. I looked at my own husband, and I thought, he doesn't care. Our son is going to that, and he doesn't care. So I took myself off, as soon as Mrs. Fawcett put her head in for the plates. I went outside, to the freezing but sunny bench, and tilted my face upward, and felt the light on my closed eyelids, and listened to the voices of the men through the dining room window. There are winter days in our part of Cornwall, which make a pale, cruel imitation of summer. After a quarter or half an hour, Tim came out and sat himself down and asked how things were faring at my end. Then more softly, "How have you been, Mother?" A little touch on the back of my hand. "Really, I mean?" "Oh, well enough," I said, and then, "I've missed you." He moved his arm, kindly, dismissively. "It's no different than when I went up to Oxford, surely." I looked at him. Of course it was different, and he dipped his head in acceptance. "In any case," I said, "Oxford, you know, I can imagine that." He accepted this too, but I instantly regretted having said it, because suddenly it was clear to me, utterly clear, as it can be only to a mother, that despite his loud, brave voice and his bright new buttons, he was frightened. Besides, I had determined not to argue with him any more. I wanted instead to say something to him, something that would make him just get through it, would prevent him from being brave. But I did not know what that thing would be. In silence, we watched a blackbird prospecting the lawn, and then he said something about the training having not been so bad. Then I asked, "But you don't know where you'll be stationed?" "They don't tell us. I rather like it." He was moving his feet around, scuffing his boots, and I almost said a sharp word to him. But of course, he was still getting used to them. Perhaps they were painful. I held back from asking about blisters, but I did press his hand, where it rested on the bench, ridiculous in its solidity, it seems now. So very warm. "You mustn't worry," Tim said, and when I didn't answer, shaded his eyes and turned to me. "All right." I looked away into the garden, and Tim looked too. I said, "Did I tell you? Theo Stainforth's mother says he's getting married." Tim shifted on the bench. "Do pass on my congratulations," he said lightly. "Good old Theo." Then Tim went away, and the waiting began. But I was born for that. My great uncle was a gunpowder maker. St. Rumans is tucked into a fold of land, deep woods stretching up to the open fields, and below to the reed beds of the estuary. But though the water is salt, there is no sight of the sea. No fishing here. The village men are employed on the Earl of Falmouth's estate, or on the farms. The same families handing down the job of gamekeeper or dairyman, father to son. Or, until the Polneath mills closed, there was powder making. Coarse powder for blasting, fine powder for shooting. Powder makers do little but wait, the incorporators especially, crouching outside their pairs of mills, listening for that catch in the workings which might mean a piece of grit, a spark, disaster. The mill hands could not smoke their tobacco, nor chew, in case it should drown out the sound of the millstones, and so they simply held the stuff silently, in either cheek. The mark of a St. Ruman's man is still a quiet manner, a ghastly brown smile. At any rate, I waited. I found it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.